So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, whenever you're listening to this. This is Machu Bailey, and this is another episode of Hip Hop's Top 10. This is where basically, you know, we celebrate the 50th anniversary of the genre of hip hop. And, you know, we just, well, in my case, you know, I'm just going to be hearing, you know, an interviewee's list of top 10 all-time favorite hip-hop albums. In the process, I'm going to try to keep this earbud steady because for some reason, this keeps slipping out of my ears. I don't know why it's happening like that today, but whatever, let's go with it. So today's guest, we have, you know, none other than Nick, you know what I mean, representing both Trinidad and NY. So
absolutely. Blessed to be here, man. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. No problem. So, you know, you could, well, at the moment here, you know, well, this is just the preamble, sorry. So, you know, you could just let the world know who you are, you know, your style of music and whatnot.
I am a Trinidadian born, New York living, rap, hip-hop, soul, R&B artist. It's very difficult to categorize what I do exactly, but it is rap to the hip-hop to the core of everything. So I blend genres of music, you know. You never know, you might hear me do a country song one day. You know, so yeah, hailing out of Queens, New York right now, and you know, just trying to make it like everybody else. So
yeah, most of. Yeah. So I am expecting to hear some East Coast albums, because you know, like in my for my list in particular, I have like all my top five, because everything else is just like from other regions of the States, right?
Right.
And, like my top five is just pure straight East Coast shit, right? Because that's the style of hip hop that I acclimatized to a lot easier, I must say, you know.
Got you.
So I'm expecting to hear some classics there, right?
For sure. No, for sure. That's East Coast rap music has definitely influenced my entire style in terms of fashion, like all the five levels or the five five pillars of hip hop, definitely East Coast. Definitely.
And it's a good thing you mentioned the five pillars to it, because you know, a lot of people just think it's all about the MCing and the DJing, but you know,
no,
the B-boy stuff, there's also the graffiti stuff, right?
For sure.
So let's waste no time. Well, you know, before we get to the top 10 list, I just want you to share your honorable mentions. It doesn't have to be a lot, but just the ones that just that top 10 list, you know.
Where do I start? I made a top 10, and then I made a top 10 honorable mentions. So I'll mention all 10 honorable mentions.
Oof, you can just run them through quickly, right?
And
the actual top 10. Then we could talk about them. Relax and talk a little bit more about
them, you know? Good Kid, Mad City, for sure. Honorable mention.
Right. And I assume that they are in no honorable mention.
No order at all.
All right, but yeah, great pick. Good Kid, Mad City. I mean, huge classic there.
Absolutely.
But why do you love it? Well, why do you love that album? In a nutshell.
Yeah, so all of these albums were chosen not only because of the amazing body of work, you know, and cohesion, of course, but it also reminds me of where I was in, like, at that part of my life, what I may have been going through, and how these albums have affected and shaped me to, you know, where I am today. Like, Good Kid, Mad City is, I think, 11 years old. A long time, bro. I was 19 or 20 when the album came out. Hard to remember where I was at, you know, at that age, and what's life was very interesting back then. So bro. so yeah, Good Kid, Mad City, Graduation, of course, by Kanye West. Another one that I was fighting to make it on my top 10 was Watch the Throne.
Good one.
Mace, Harlem World, Jay-Z. Mace is in my top 10 favorite rappers, just based on style and fashion, mm-hmm. and you know, just that whole braggadocious, I think they call it the shiny suit era. A lot of people don't like that era. Maybe if I grew up in that time, I wouldn't like it either. But I have grown to really appreciate it, especially as of late. You know.
Yeah, well, I was aware of when that era took place, and I was like, "Oh my god, what house? This is terrible!" I was like, "No, is the genre evolving?" So
exactly,
you can hate on Diddy and Mace all you want to, but
right,
something to move the culture, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, Harlem World, Reasonable Doubt, of course, Jay-Z, mm-hmm. No Way Out, Puff, you know, Diddy.
All right. Not an album that I go back to, honestly, though, but back in 97, yeah, of course, when, you know, Biggie died, I mean, that it was a big deal, you know. I'll Be Missing You was
everywhere,
like on the radio, just constantly, you know what I mean? But there were other great songs there as well, right? But it had a rather somber tone, even though you had your bangers, like Been Around the World and Benjamin and stuff like that.
There are when I go back to that album, these are albums that I actually listen to on the regular. No Way Out is a perfect example. It was not until last week I actually listened to that album from top to bottom, because usually I would just skim through it and just listen to, like, you know, my favorite songs, like Here or There and stuff like that. And when I listened to it, like, from top to bottom, I realized how influential this album was. Like, I heard one song in particular, I think it's called I Love You Baby with Black Rob.
With Black Rob, yes.
And I didn't realize that
instrument, that, sorry, that production, boy.
I didn't realize, but Fabolous has a song called, I think it's called Lullaby. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's called Lullaby. I'll tell you the name of it right now, because I don't want to mess it up.
Is it like his version of that song, I think?
Yes. It's called I Miss My Love. It's on the Lo Sooe album. And I had no clue, because I love that Fabolous song so much. Like, I like that Lo Sooe album so much. But I had no clue that he basically took that idea from that song. And I was, I was blown. Even the first two lines, I met her uptown in Dykeman. That's Black Rob all the way, bro. Some of my other favorite songs, like Senorita. I didn't know years later DJ Khaled would use that same sample and flip it into You Stay with Jeremiah. Okay. Like, why? Tell me why. That song? Yeah, it's same, but yeah, that's No Way Out. Perfect album to me. Shine's debut, Shine, I love that album.
That's one I really should recap, though. I mean, I know the big two singles were, and it's so funny too to bring that up, because the two big singles from it were driven by Barrett and Levy, right?
Absolutely. Tracks,
right?
Absolutely.
Bad Boy and Bunny and Shine.
Bunny and Shine. Yep. But the Shine is an album that I was listening to when I was probably like 9-10 years old, when I had no business listening to these albums. Yeah, I have two old. So a little bit about my background. I was born and raised Superior. Growing up, you know, two brothers, a father, and they only listened to dancehall, reggae, soca, calypso. Like, my dad had Mighty Sparrow CDs, like the actual album CDs. He had Baron actual, like, CDs, cassettes. And it wasn't until, like, I got older that two of my cousins, they actually put me on to rap hip-hop music. They were the only people that I knew that had, like, you remember back in the days, they had, I don't want to call it mixtape CDs, but they had, like, these burn CDs with different songs on them. Right, so my first introduction to hip hop was Until the End of Time by Tupac.
Nice. That's the first
hip hop song I ever heard, and I was probably eight going on nine at that time. right? Because I was born in 92.
I can imagine how you felt when you heard just that beat alone, because the beat is so transcendent, but my God, yeah.
It was interesting because I remember not being able to understand what he was saying, but his voice made it evoked something out of me. It made me feel something deep in that song. And then to you know, as I got older, and then to realize, yo, he wasn't even alive when the song came out, but his words and his tone and voice still affected me in that way. It's absolutely crazy. But yeah, so but Shine, Nas, I Am. Another crazy one.
Good pick there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
You know, one of the big songs, of course, is Hate Me Now. But my one takeaway from that album is Nas is like, it just had one of the best Nas and Primo collabs ever, in my opinion.
Can I speak to something real quick? I know. I don't want to go off on a tangent, but I Am is one of those albums to me that, so I don't know if you know the history of that album. That album got leaked way before it was supposed to be released.
Yes,
before it was released, the source did a review on the album and it gave it 5 mics. And just based on the incredible storytelling and just from top to bottom of that album was supposed to be 2 discs. First album was supposed to be he was supposed to be Nas, right? And then he was coming back as Nostradamus.
Right.
That's why the end of I Am there's Undying Love, and then this two he was supposed to come back as Nostradamus. That's why in sequence he did put out I Am, and then he did put out like Nostradamus.
If that
album had came out how it was originally supposed to, there would not have been any debate on who was better or who is better between Nas and Jay-Z at that time.
Right.
Because of the incredible originality and thought that he actually put into those songs. I actually have what I believe is the original version of the album. And it's it doesn't have Hate Me Now on it, because Hate Me Now was created after those leaks came about. But that album is incredible to me. I Am, Get Rich or Die Trying.
Of course, you know, the album of 2003, right?
Yeah. To Pimp a Butterfly, Kendrick.
Yep. One of my all-time
favorites.
Yep.
Blueprint, Jay-Z.
Mm-hmm.
And Black Album. I was actually fighting to put Black Album on this list, but it could make it. it could make it.
and just to touch quickly on the Black Album, right? I will never forget how big of a deal it was, because we were all thinking, it's the final one, it's the final Jay-Z album.
Encore, right?
Like, encore sounds like this is the end, you know? And we all wanted it, right? But regardless of all that, it's still a great body of work.
A major reason why Black Album is an honorable mention to me is solely because of the song Allah.
I love that song. That's a great.
That's like, one of the best songs.
Penultimate track, like leading up to the final track. It just sets that mood so well.
Mm-hmm. That song is. I mean, obviously, it's a lot of other like good songs on that album, but that song in particular is one of my favorite Hope songs for real.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So. Top 10. Well, I should say, you know, great honorable mentions list there. That's great there.
But
let me now get to the real reason.
I get to the nitty-gritty.
Nitty-gritty, right?
Yes.
So, number 10. What is Nick's number 10?
My Dark, Beautiful, Twisted Fantasy. Or did I not? My Beautiful, Dark, Twisted Fantasy. There you go.
Yeah.
Look at you.
identifying what I don't like the most. So I think it's time for us to have a toast. Let's have a toast for the douchebags. Let's have a toast for the assholes. Let's have a toast for the scumbags. Every one of them that I know. Let's have a toast for the jerkos. Gotta never take work off. Maybe I got a plan. Run away fast as you can.
She find pictures in my email. I sent this bitch a picture of my dick. I don't know what it is with females, but I'm not too good at that shit. See, I can have me a good girl and still be addicted to them hood rats. And I just blame everything on you. At least you know that's what I'm good at. And I always find, yeah, I always find, yeah, I always find something wrong.
You've been putting up with my shit just way too long. I'm so gifted at finding what I don't like the most. So I think it's time for us to have a toast. Let's have a toast for the douchebags. Let's have a toast for the assholes. Let's have a toast for the scumbags. Every one of them that I know. Let's have a toast for the jerkos. Gotta never take work off. Maybe I got a plan. Run away fast as you can.
Run away from the baby. Run away. Run away from the baby. Run away. Little thing get crazy. Run away. Get the long plan. Run away as fast. From me, baby. Run away. Run away from me, baby. Run away. Gonna fuck get crazy. Why can't she just run away? Baby, I got a plan. Run away as fast as you can.
Oh boy, what year was this? 2010?
And, you know, as I mentioned in a previous episode, I'll never forget, like, Complex did a list of greatest albums of the 2010s, right?
Yeah.
Number one. And I was like, yeah.
I don't
believe. I totally understand. That makes a lot of sense. It does. It was in my top five favorite albums of the 2010s. It wasn't my number one. My number one was To Pimp a Butterfly, right? But My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, boy, just so influential. What Kanye was able to do with that album, you know, just stepped everything up production wise, you know, lyric wise, and guest features, dude. It's just
absolutely
he was able to put all absolutely together.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, for me, this album just represents excellence, hip hop at the purest form. To me, this album, the production. This is one of those albums that sounds polished but raw.
Mm-hmm.
Like polished in terms of the overall song, but very raw drums. You know, I mean, I remember hearing Power for the first time, bro. I was like, we could cuss?
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck is this? Just based on production alone. And then I remember seeing him do the Coachella performance, and that as well. It was like, yo, this guy, you know, my favorite song on there though is Hell of a Life.
Okay.
Just based on the production, again, production alone. Fun fact about this album, I categorize albums in terms of like classic, however. So I have perfect albums, and then there are classic albums, and then there are perfect classic albums.
Alright.
A perfect album is when you could listen to an album 1 to 12 and there are no skips.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So to me, that's a perfect album. A classic album is an album where you might have a skip, maybe one or two or maybe three or whatever, but just based on the material, maybe the year when it came out and how influential it is or was, it becomes a classic in a sense. And then there are perfect classic albums where there's, you know, there's both. And to me, this album is a perfect classic album. There is nothing on here that I would see myself skipping. I'm looking at the track list now. Dark Fantasy, Crazy, Gorgeous, Crazy, Power. All of the Lights to Interlude. Maybe I would skip that, but I wouldn't skip it. All of the Lights.
It sets the tone.
It sets the tone, yeah. Right? Like, so, Monster. I mean, I don't even need to spill. So, yeah, Paul.
Nicki Minaj, right? That's all yeah, that's like, Monster, right? That's
yo. Yeah. Devil in a New Dress. Funny thing about these Rick Ross songs, because he was featured on Monster and Devil in a New Dress. So, Rick Ross has a song on Tough London called Live Fast, Die Young.
Right.
That was actually intended to be on this album.
Okay.
And, because Ross did the two verses, Kanye gave him that song. That's why Kanye is featured on the song. But that was actually supposed to be on this album. And right. I could only imagine if that song was on this album, how much... Because that's one of my favorite Ross songs.
Alright.
So I could only imagine if that song was on this album, how much even crazier this album would be. Runaway Pusha T. I mean, besides Pusha T's nice ass verse, this was the first time where I heard a song in hip hop that, how long is the song? Like 14 minutes?
Is it 14 or is it 11?
It's 9 minutes. It's a little over 9 minutes, but I had never heard a song like this that. There was a song, there was the verses, and then he just did like this
auto-tune stuff.
Yeah, and I was like...
And it kind of fits though, it's weird. It definitely did.
And what he did on Blame Game with John Legend. Same type of...
We're bringing in Chris Rock.
Crazy
it's
album.
It's just that thought process to say, this is how I want to end my
Yeah. Know, And it definitely influenced me in terms of how I create music. I know that we're in an era where most songs are, you know, they're like within the 2:18 to 2 minute 30 second like range.
Which I don't want to say hate. It's just like.
Yeah.
Give us more, man. Give us like 3.5.
I appreciate it for what it is, but I try to create long format music. I try to create music, you know, like if I could make something that's like 7 minutes, I would honestly do it. If I could figure it out, I would do it. You know, that's why most of my songs, they're over 4 minutes for the most part. You know.
Yeah.
So
record, Something About Rain, segues into different beats and whatnot. That was one reason why I loved it so much, that you were just able to pull something like that off, you know.
I appreciate it, bro. Definitely a lot of thoughts, and I don't remember when I was creating it, like thinking about like, you know, this album in particular, Dark Twisted, but subconsciously the thought was there, like, you know, I don't want to make something short. I don't like making short interlude is different, but you know, as far as like songs, definitely, like, this is the influence for me that was like, yo, I like making long format music,
right?
So yeah, definitely. Okay. Definitely this album.
Yeah, great pick. So what's your number nine?
King's Disease 2, Nas.
Bottomless Bellinis, afternoon sun. Girls twerking on the tables, they just having fun. Leave them girls alone, you the owner, what you own. Buckets of Don P, how many you want? My nigga, he brought his son, got his dad's face. We ordered crab cakes, table with mad plates. R&B playlist, I'm in blast space. She told me about her last date, I had to laugh in her face. Yo, that's brunch on Sundays. Bring the hookah to the table, she gon' smoke it till her lungs ache. That's brunch on Sundays. Posting pictures on the gram, hashtagging Sunday Funday. Going Chocolate City, DC girl Sadiddy. Valley Park the Wraith, here's 150. Fitted master linen master tennis. Net worth master image.
Shorty was an AKA, best friend was a Delta. Bringing up her student loans, I told her that I felt her. Flyest women on the yard, now they work for Delta. New Chanel slides, slip them off like Cinderella. That's brunch on Sundays. Mad blunts, real runch, girls trying to act up. Gotta keep it classy, this ain't time to act tough. Eye to eye when we toast, we don't need no bad luck.
Nice, nice, nice.
Yeah.
That was a record for me. That actually wrote me in even more into that trilogy, right?
That trilogy.
I would say like the first one was fine and it won the Grammy. I was like, all right, but I was rooted for Alfredo, to be honest. That's the Freddie Gibbs and
Alchemist album. Amazing album.
Yeah, but when King's Disease 2 came out, I was like, all right, this should have won the Grammy. And it's like, no, it didn't. But it was still a great album, nonetheless.
I agree.
This is where I felt the series was coming into form, right? Especially the chemistry between Nas and Hit-Boy, right?
Absolutely.
The third one, I love that one as well, right? And I would say, at the moment, I can't really pick between 2 and 3 because I love both of them so much, right? I mean, I enjoy 1, right? But it's really 2 and 3 I really love, right?
Right.
I mean, at the moment, I can't say which one I prefer, 2 or 3, right? But just to kick things off, why 2 and not 3?
Why 2 and not 3? Well, 2, the difference between 2 and 3 to me is 2 is more musically inclined. Tree reminds me of Illmatic Nas, where it's a lot of long format verses, and while I have no problem with it, like I love it, but I like music at the end of the day. I like to listen to music, so I like music where it could just be like a full verse and that's the end of the song, but I also like music where there's hooks, there's bridges, and to me, I think production-wise, 2 has better production than 3.
Okay, fair enough.
And just going off of like some of my favorite Nas songs are on this album, like Crusher. One of my favorite Nas, probably one of, I put it in my top 10 like favorite Nas songs. Moments is like, so from the production,
I love the beat for Moments.
Yeah, for Moments, from production to the thing that he was speaking about. I never met Muhammad Ali, wish I did. My brother saw him, Chip told him nothing is real, gave me the chills. You know what I mean? Like, thought about it, that's how I feel. We on like, No Phony Love, Charlie Wilson, Brunch on Sundays. I love the fact that Nas makes like these types of mature hip-hop songs, because it pushes, I mean, for he's not trying to be like young, he is being himself, and by making these songs he's obviously pushing the culture forward for artists 40 or even 35 and up. So for example, like songs like Brunch on Sundays, songs like Daughters, for example, songs like Once a Man, Twice a Child, on Katy Tree, First Time, for or like all these are examples of these like mature contemporary hip hop that Nas is definitely pushing out there. Nobody, Lauryn Hill, Store Run.
Oh, wait, say that. That's my favorite. Lauryn Hill,
Nobody. Yeah.
Ooh, I love it.
Usually when people tap Lauryn Hill as a feature, they usually want her to sing. He got her to rap, first of all. Yeah. So that in itself is like a feat. Nas is good. One of my favorite beats in on this album in general. Rare. Death Row East. When I heard this song, I was looking for a vintage Death Row East shirt. I just wanted the t-shirt, bro. Like,
right.
That beat is crazy. EPMD 2, Eminem.
Love that. Eminem's verse on that, though. Holy shit.
Yeah.
I mean, not just Eminem, but he got, like, Nas got EPMD to show up.
EPMD. Yeah. Right? YKTV, like, I love, like, this is top to bottom. This is, I would say that I would put this in my top 5 favorite Nas albums. I think it's a top 5 Nas album to me. I think it's the best in the KD series. not counting magic.
Yeah.
Not counting magic, but I definitely put that up there as far as like, yeah, like, and so I have Apple Music. I, you know, at the end of the year, Apple Music will send you like a list of things that you listen to the most of the year. And that was at the top of the list, and I wasn't surprised.
Nice.
I listened to it this year too, so it will probably top this year too. So, you know, and Bitter Inside is definitely an inspiration for what I'm currently cooking up. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Alright. Alright, man. So number 8. What's in
number 8? 444 by Jay-Z.
Nice.
Back when Ratchet was a ratchet and the Vixen was a Vixen and Jam Master Jay was a lob. I was mixing, cooking coke in the kitchen. Back when Robin was a piston, Mike was losing to Isaiah, but he soon would get his 6-1. Gave birth to my verbal imagination. Assume a virtue if you have not. Or better yet, here's a verse from Hamlet. Lord, we know who we are, yet we know not what we may be. So maybe I'm the one, or maybe I'm crazy. I'm from Marcy houses where the boys die by the thousand. Back when Pam was on Martin, yeah, that's where it all started. When Dizel was blotting carpet, alpaca. 9mm when Slick Rick made Mona Lisa. When Lisa Bonet was Beyonce of a day, I had divas, y'all. Think I just popped up in this bitch like a fetus, nah. Pregnant pause, give you some second thoughts. It's room on the bandwagon, don't abort Marcy me. Marcy me, streets is my artery. Vein of my existence, I'm the Gotham City heartbeat. I started in lobbies now. Polly with Saudis, I'm a Sufi to Goofies. I could probably speak Farsi, that's poetry. Rika coca leaf from my past. Came through the bushes smelling like roses. I need a trophy just for that. Old Brooklyn, not this new shit. Shit feel like a spoof. Fat laces in your shoe, I'm talking busting off the roof. Hold a Uzi vertical, let the thing smoke. Y'all flirting with death, I be winking through the scope. Shout out to all the murderers, turn murals, plural. Fuck the Federal Bureau. Shout out to Nostranad, Flushing that Myrtle. All the County of Kings, may your ground stay fertile. Shout out to Big Papa, Daddy Kane, heroes. Thus concluding my concerto.
It has become my favorite Jeezy album.
Okay.
If you asked me my top 10 hip hop albums, maybe 3-4 years ago, it would obviously be a way different list, but where I am today and the things that I'm thinking about and just trying to build and, you know, become financially secure my future, and just secure myself mentally, physically, spiritually, this album has definitely been a big help for me in terms of, like, so we'll start off with Kill Jay-Z, which is like killing the ego. Story of OJ, speaking about you know, things that he could have done way back in the day when he had money. Instead, he was spending money on cars and girls, and no, you know, but it was a different time back then. We didn't have the information that we do now. But imagine if we had it. Imagine if, I don't want to say black people, just black people, but imagine if people of color had this information back then, how much further along we would be. And not just in America, of course, I'm speaking in all countries. I'm speaking about Trinidad, speaking about Guyana, speaking about everywhere. So, Smile, Gloria Carter, amazing song. But on top of that, that third verse, he went absolutely crazy. I think he used that particular song, that third verse, to just go absolutely crazy. A master of my aesthetics. I know you often heard me wax poetic by being back in Alexa, but trust me, that was nothing. Like, he went nuts.
Yeah.
Caught Their Eyes, Frank Ocean, amazing. 444 resonated with me personally.
I got punch of a track, sorry, and I just love how Jeezy was just so candid. Not, I don't want to use candid. He was just so open about it. It's just like, yes, I apologize.
Yes.
I'm sorry. This is tough. Formerly known as Big Pimpin' Jeezy, apologizing to my wife here.
And this was also the first album, I should say the only album thus far, where we got an incredibly amount of vulnerability from him.
Yeah.
You know, and which made him, I mean, he for the most part has been relatable to me, but this has just made me more you know, this album made me a lot more relatable to him, and like similar things that, you know, well, things that he was going through that was similar to things that I have went through as well. So I could relate to an aspect, you know. Obviously, I'm a top billionaire, but yeah. Family Feud, and after 444, he got Beyonce to sing on Family Feud.
Yeah, that I love the hook on that song, by the way.
That beat is crazy. Completely crazy. Bam with Junior Gong.
Love that song. Like, you know, that dropped as a single. All right, so I'll talk quickly, right? No ID's production on that is amazing.
I was actually going to speak to that.
If you remember, if you remember way back when, right, Gorilla Black, right, had a song called Compton, and
yes,
that same sample, right,
Sister Nancy.
Yeah, right. How No ID was able to chop that up was different, though. It was like, and you just layer it on top of each other. Just how he was able to do that,
yeah,
in my mind, that was amazing. Right.
That's exactly what I was going to say. I was going to say, many people have used the sample before, but no one has been able to manipulate it as originally as No ID has. I don't really have much to say. I mean, Moonlight's crazy.
Yeah.
Massimi is my favorite song on this album. Yeah, I just,
it's
like
the favorite of many. I know. Yeah. I know,
yeah. It's from even talking about it right now, like, it raises the hair on my skin, gives me goosebumps. It's from from production first is like the production on this album. It reminds me of if Watch the Throne and Dark Twisted Fantasy had a child.
Okay.
And
you mean like classy in a sense, or what do you mean?
Yeah, it just the production, it just reminds me of those albums. It to me, it sounds like if there was like a trilogy. Like one, obviously, like one, two, like this would be, in terms of production, this would be like the final, you know, this would be number three.
Imagine that, though, if it was a trilogy, right? For Dark, then Watch It Throne, and then 444, like this, those three together. That's real interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and of course, Legacy. I mean,
yeah,
it speaks to, you know.
I'll always say this: if this is the last song that, if this is the last album that, you know, G ever puts out,
yeah,
this song is like a great closing track. Like, this is like, that could be the end of his discography right there.
Yeah, no, definitely, because it speaks to everything that he has done and what he will continue to do after he's not here. So I mean, beautiful song. But you know, what I like about this album is I really appreciate the simplicity of it. I appreciate the fact that it was very short and it was very to the point in terms of lyrics and production. It's another one of those albums that, like I mentioned before, didn't really have a lot of hooks, just mostly like verses, long format, regular format, like six, could be 32, could be 16, could be 64, but everything that was said on there was just, not only was it needed, but it was just perfect in terms of what was said and how he formatted those verses and these songs. To me, it's another perfect classic album that there are no skips on this album. Well, for me, I should say, at least, you know.
Yeah. Agreed.
And to add last and you know, just to add a last thing, this is the second, as far as I know, this is the second No ID entirely produced album. The first one that I'm aware of is The Dreamer, The Believer by Common.
All right. I have to look it up, but I think Resurrection, that's Common's second album, was entirely produced by No ID. I could be wrong with that one, right?
But I know he has done stuff on there. I don't know, but I can't say whether it was produced entirely by him. But I wouldn't doubt it because that was the guy. That was his guy back in the day. So
yeah. But I really love The Dreamer. The Dreamer, The Believer.
I love that too. I love that too.
Favorite records of 2011, actually.
I love that album as well. That's one of my favorite projects as well. Should have been on the honorable mentions, actually, but I forgot.
This is actually the first time in this series that we mentioned that Common has been mentioned, right?
A
Common album has been mentioned, so Common, some more love.
Absolutely,
forward,
absolutely.
Yeah, alright.
It's Common.
It's Common, right?
It's Common. Right.
So, number 7. What's your number 7?
Midnight Marauders.
The night is on my mind. The sun is still shining. But the night is on my mind. So Paul A while I drop this rhyme. See, Jake be getting illy when the sun get dark. He be coming out the heads, but you don't let me start. There's activities aplenty in the nighttime. So the ghetto child it seems to be the right time. See, kids be getting stuck with jewels or fly gimmicks. Shorty see the action and then start to mimic. Running to the corner, the dice game is blazing. Looking at the loop, it seems so amazing. Puts the short down to be exact 1 pound. He shakes the stones in his hands, then he lets it down. Scared money don't make none. He threw a trip on the ace, now he's out, son. Hits the local bodega to wolf down a hero. Sun is on a midnight run like De Niro. Spots a shorty rock standing on his block. The fiends be hounding him to pump, so we asked if it's not. Conversation that he kicked to the shorty was a sly one. Increased intensity, cause there she was a fly one. Took her to the crib, there she ran her jigs about mind upliftment and being positive. He yawned and he sighed till 105. Then he finally realized the honey was alive. At least he didn't plan on building for the evening. Threw the feel out on the dome and said, come on, yo, we leaving. Came out on the scene as he told her to beep him. Saw his man stand with a blunt in his hand. You know the transaction. Brothers getting lost in the weed satisfaction. Coming down the block, man, loud as. You would swear Red Man was inside the truck. As the night seemed darker, cops is on the hunt. They interrupt your cipher and crush your blunt. See you left your work at home, so they pat you down for nothing. Why in the hell does 10-4 keep fronting? You push through the park even though it's still dark. The kid is nice on the hoop, he said I spot you true. The night is on my mind. The sun is still shining. But now the night is on the mind. The night is on the mind. The night is on your mind. Ayo, the sun is still shining. But now the night is on the mind. As for me, I'm a.
That's my number one pick. In case you ordered, that's my number one.
That's your number one.
But talk about that before.
I don't blame you.
Why you love that album?
Oh, boy. First of all, I live very close to where they grew up currently. I live on London Boulevard. I passed their street all the time, you know, like after Five died, they had put gave like Five Dog Avenue. I was there for that. They did a mural. I passed it damn near every day. I always say I want to stop and take a picture one time, but I never really find or have like the time to do it. Aside from all of that, this album, when I was beginning to take music seriously, this was in the early 2010s. This was something that I would listen to a lot. Q-Tip is a very big inspiration to me. I've been told that our voice is very similar. I don't really know what to make of it. I'll take it as a compliment, but I mean, I don't really think so. But
is that so, it's not like
demanding? Yeah,
smooth. It has a smooth.
Yeah. Right. And but there are so many songs on here that I just love. I still don't even know why, but it just sounds, it's really pleasing to me.
Mm-hmm.
Our tour, Stir It Up, My favorite song on here is Midnight.
Nice, yeah. I love the beat for that. I love the story. The storytelling in that is great, yeah.
As for me, I'm a nocturnal animal. God concentrates on the young black man to make the brother seek snake. The nighttime is busy, that's where to all kizzy is the sound we get down. Your son, you know, the like,
yeah,
floors, we can get down, electric relaxation. I mean, of course,
one of the greatest songs ever made.
Is it the Chase Part 2 where it has the Bismarcky sample?
Yeah,
I'm about to wreck your body. It's a turn of body. Yeah,
like the first time I heard that I went nuts. And that was before I even listened to Bismarcky's album, right? Yeah,
like that, you know. And then I didn't know until years later that Five Dog is actually Trinidadian, and that even made me like the album even more.
I like how he always kind of shouts it out. Not all the time, I never saw it.
You will hear it. Yeah, sure, exactly.
And he would throw out some reference to dancehall or whatever.
Lyrics to go. But yeah, this definitely, if this album did make this top 10 list, it would probably be Low End Theory. Mm-hmm. I actually wanted to put Low End Theory first because one of my favorite Tribe songs is the first song on the album. I actually forgot the name of it.
Excursions.
You know, when I was a teenager, before I had status and before I had a pager, you can find the abstract listening to hip hop. Yes.
Great way to kick off that album. I will not lie. Yeah.
Yeah, bro. But yeah, that's definitely number 7. Right. Not upset that it's, not surprised that it's your number 1, honestly. You know? Yeah. Alright,
Number 6. What's your number
6? Number 6 is Illmatic by Nas.
Before a blunt, I take out my fronts, then I start the front. Matter of fact, I'll be on a manhunt. You couldn't catch me in the streets without a ton of reefer. That's like Malcolm X catching a jungle fever. King poetic, too much flavor, I'm major. Atlanta ain't braver, I pull a number like a pager. Cause I'm an ace when I face the base. 40 side is the place that is giving me grace. Now wait, another dose, say you might be dead. And I'm a Nike head, I wear chains that excite the feds. Ain't a damn thing gonna change. I'ma perform a strange show to Mike. Warmer was born the game. Nas, why did you do it? You know you got the mad fat fluid when you rhyme. It's halftime. It's halftime. Hey yo, it's halftime. It's halftime.
But of course. I've talked about it. That's my third favorite hip hop album.
Third favorite.
Again, East Coast shit, right? So, yeah. Why do you love Illmatic?
What can I say about this album that has not been said?
That is how you always kick off an Illmatic review. Kind of the same thing. It's like, yeah, what more can be said about it, right?
What more? I can tell you that I rhymed over It Ain't Hard to Tell. A different version though. It's out there. Like I won't say where to find it because I was definitely much, much younger, but it's out there somewhere. Represent is one of my favorite songs, because of the beat.
On that beat, yeah. And there's actually two versions of it though. So
there's a demo version, which is the original version. I've heard that as well. State of Mind, you know.
World on that beat. Yep.
Life's a Bitch, World Is Yours. I saw Nas. Nas did a show at the Garden in February.
I saw you put something on IG, and I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Nas, Madison Square Garden. Why wasn't I there?
it was his first time. It was his first time at the Garden, actually.
Really?
He never played the Garden before. Maybe he did it before, but I should say it was his first time as a solo act at the Garden.
Okay.
and he was doing the King's Disease trilogy, and he did like a blend of those three albums, and he left and he dressed and he came back as Stillmatic Nas. Like, he came in like all orange, Scully Average jacket, Timberland boots, and I was just thinking, oh bro, like,
of course
that's fucking nice. Wow. But he brought out AZ to do Life's a Bitch.
Life's a Bitch, yeah.
He did the
verse that made AZ who he is, yeah.
Absolutely. He did the third verse to Memory Lane a cappella. I wish I had recorded it. But it was such a moment. This album almost did not make my list, and I'll tell you why. I've listened to this album so many times that it's almost boring to me, and I've almost gotten used to it. Like, you know when you listen to something all the time, you're kind of
in the background at times.
Yeah, but I had to, like, I don't mean to spill the beans, but when we had this conversation last week and I'd sent you my list, I actually thought about it, and I was like, nah, let me actually like review this list and let me actually think about what it is I wanna do. And I went back and I re-listened to all of these albums, and I was like, nah, like, this has to be on here, because this definitely helped shape me into being the introspective / lyrical person that I am.
Nice.
You know? Big inspiration, like, huge. Nas is my favorite rapper by far, so
nice.
You know.